Open our Bibles to the book of 1 Samuel, chapter 3. 1 Samuel, chapter 3. And we'll be going over chapters 3 and 4 this evening. If you need a Bible, by the way, feel free to pop up and grab one. We have plenty in the back there. 1 Samuel chapters 3 and 4. Let's go ahead and pray as we're opening up the Word. Lord Jesus, what a blessing it is once again to come and feast at your table, Lord. I ask, Lord, that you would speak to each one of us through your living Word this evening, that our hearts, Lord, would set aside the cares of this day, Lord. Set aside the secularism of this week, Lord, and focus upon you, Lord, through your word, by your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Now, as we come back here into the book of Samuel, we remember that Samuel's mother, Hannah, and his father, Elkanah, had dedicated Samuel unto the Lord, and they had brought him to Eli, the priest, when he was probably about 4 or 5 years old, and to serve the Lord at the house of the Lord in Shiloh. And as we read at the end of chapter 1, it's kind of neat where it says, he worshiped the Lord there. Samuel was a worshiper of the Lord, and yet we read in chapter 2 that Eli's sons, Hophni and Phinehas, were wicked and evil men. They too were priests, just like their father Eli, but they were stealing from the portions, the offerings that the people were bringing to the Lord. And if the people objected to it, they would be beaten and driven away, and they would still take. They were also fornicating with the very women who had come to serve the Lord there in Shiloh. So they're just wicked guys. In verse 12 of chapter 2, we read, "Now the sons of Eli were worthless men. They did not know the Lord." And yet, you know what? They were also priests. It's kind of a scary thing when you see that. You know, we also read a little later in chapter 2 that Eli was rebuked because of his sons. That Eli rebuked his sons. And yet that rebuke had no punishment behind it. There was no consequences for them ignoring the rebuking of their father, for they would not listen, the Bible says, to the voice of their father. And it was, we even read that it was the will of the Lord to put them to death. And so it's interesting, we also read in verse 27 of chapter 2 that a man of God came to rebuke Eli for his sons and their wickedness, their blaspheming against the Lord. And that he also said that Eli's house would be cut off, all the strength would be cut off, that his sons Hophni and Phinehas would die in the same day. We read that in verse 34 of chapter 2. In verse 35, we read that the Lord himself would raise up for himself a faithful priest who shall do according to what is in my heart and in my mind. And that leads us here to chapter 3. Look at verse 1 of chapter 3. "Now the young man Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. And the word of the Lord was rare in those days. There was no frequent vision." You know, it is indeed a sad time for the people of God when the word of the Lord is a rare thing. Remember, these are the days, you know, of basically when the Word of God was being written. You know, all this time, and God wanted to speak to the people of Israel, and yet they were not seeking the Lord. They were seeking what was right in their own eyes. Yet the Lord wanted them to seek to them to do what was right in the eyes of the Lord. And they had the first 5 books of the law. They could, you know, go back and see his will, but they were ignoring it. And thus the presence of the Lord was, we read here, quote unquote, rare in those days. There was no frequent vision. The Lord was not speaking through men and giving them vision. And why was this? Because the very priests, including Eli, were doing what was right in their own eyes, not what was right in the eyes of the Lord. You see, today we have much the same thing happening. Even as the Lord said it would happen in the last days, there would be a great falling away that, you know, people would do. You know, in Timothy we read about those who become lovers of themselves, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, we read, but denying the power thereof. You know, there's so many who profess Christ today and even preach Him from the pulpit, yet are not preaching the Word of God. So many who want to preach Christ, yet without using the Word of God. I just read today of a pastor here in Washington who basically decided not too long ago that homosexuality was okay and to welcome it into the church. Hundreds of people left his church. He said he had all these people coming to him with their Bibles open, showing him where this was sin. And he said, this was a quote. He said, "I don't care what the Bible says." Wickedness. Again, here's a man who's doing right in his own eyes. And yet so many Christians flock still, or professing Christians, I say, you know, flock to these, you know, people. You see, they are starving the sheep of God. "Peter, do you love me? Feed my sheep. Tend my lambs. Feed my sheep." The main job of a pastor is to preach the Word of God, to equip the saints for the work of the ministry. And you know what, beloved? It is rare in these days. And it is honestly getting rarer. As so many people look at people like us and say, "You guys are nutcases," or whatever. But you know, when we don't have the Word of God being taught, we don't have God's vision for people's lives. Now, I'm not talking about some vision. Let's, you know, close our eyes and meditate on our belly buttons and all this weird, crazy stuff. And we laugh, but there's a lot of that coming into the church today in the guise of spiritual discipline. Hey, we're to meditate, but the Bible is very clear what we're to meditate upon. It's the Word of God first and foremost. You see, we receive a vision for what the Lord has for our lives as we read and study and memorize and obey the Word of God. We see God's vision for our lives. We see God's vision for this world. But you see, it's not just true from the pulpits, but it's true of people in their own personal lives, not valuing the Word of God in their own lives, yet wondering why they're not hearing freshly from the Lord. And if they are hearing, they're not hearing from God, but I believe from demons and doctrines of demons, the Bible says. You see, because our flesh loves to do what is right in our own eyes. You have an amen? Dude, I raise my hand highest. My flesh still likes to do what's right and what seems right, by the way, in my own eyes. Hey, this seems right, but does it go with the Word of God? You see, when you think about this, it's so interesting as we keep coming. This is one of the central themes of the Word of God from the book of Genesis chapter 3 all the way to the book of Revelation through chapter 20 and even into 21. Where man is still rebelling against God, wanting our own way. And remember, Israel, if you talk to the Israelis back then, if we could all of a sudden transport back, they would say we're men and women of God, of Yahweh, Jehovah, that He is our God. And yet they were doing what seems right, what was right in their own eyes. May God's word not be rare in our lives, beloved in Christ. Can I have an amen? Hey, we each one of us here need to be a man, need to be a woman of the Word of God. You know, we live in days where there is craziness being taught. And I'll be honest with you, and the Bible warns, let not many become teachers, because I'm going to be held to a stricter judgment. I understand that and I fear that. But to be honest, be careful, because I am just a man. Hold everything I teach up to the Word of God. And we can't do that. Don't just do it by memory. Don't just do it by, well, I think that sounds right, or I think that sounds off. What does God's Word say? That's why we need to be men and women reading through the Word of God every day, every week, every month, every year of our lives, to be pouring out. And again, the awesome part about that is we'll also receive fresh visions from the Lord on how to live our lives, what to do, who to be, empowered by the Spirit of God to go forth into this world. Now look at verse 2. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, maybe that's kind of what happened because his spiritual sight had already gone dim, huh? But he was lying down in his own place. Verse 3, the lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called Samuel, and he said, here I am. And he ran to Eli and said, here I am, for you called me. But he, Eli, said, I did not call, lie down again. So he went and lay down. And the Lord called again Samuel, and Samuel arose and went to Eli and said, here I am, for you called me. But he said, I did not call you, my son, lie down again. Verse 7, now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. And the Lord called Samuel again the third time, and he rose and went to Eli and said, here I am, for you called me. Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the young man. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, go, lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, speak, Lord, for your servant listeneth. So Samuel went and lay down in his place. You know, just a quick, brief, you know, turn here. It's interesting that Samuel did not yet know the voice of the Lord. He had not yet learned to listen to and to listen for the voice of God. You know, it's interesting. The Bible tells us that the Lord is always, you know, wanting to speak, always wanting to use and show himself strong on behalf of those. And a matter of fact, 2 Chronicles 16:9 says that very thing. For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show himself strong on behalf of those whose heart is loyal to him. Amen? Amen. And he's calling out. In Isaiah verse 6, or chapter 6, verse 8, we hear this. Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send, and who will go for us? And I said, here I am, send me. You know, the Lord is always calling to each one of us in different ways. And again, listening to his word, listening by his Holy Spirit, to be men and women who are continually ready to hear from the word of the Lord. But it's interesting, note here that we see that Samuel, you know, when he heard the voice of God calling to him, he went to the one who is leading him spiritually, Eli. Now, it's interesting, so he heard the voice of the Lord calling. He thought it was Eli, so he went. But it was interesting that he learned from Eli wisdom in his spiritual life. He learned to go the right direction. Eli said, look, man, I'm going to point you in the right direction. You see, Samuel did not understand as a young man what was going on, as the Lord kept calling out to him three times, and yet Eli recognize this. Even in the midst of his sinfulness with his sons, Eli, his wisdom and knowing walking with the Lord, when he did, or, you know, again, it's a whole rocky, weird thing with him, but he recognized this. There are those who are younger in the faith, and you need to be willing, we need to be willing to listen to those who are older in the faith. Can I have an amen? I'm not talking older year-wise. And sometimes I'm not even talking older in the faith year-wise. Well, how long have you been a Christian? 32 years. Well, I'm 33 years, so you need to obey me or listen to me. Or, hey, I've been a Christian for a year and I'm looking up to somebody. I'm not talking about, we need people who are actually mature in the Lord, mature in his word. Amen? So we could have been a Christian for 50 years, 20 years, but am I a mature man or woman of the Word of God by the Spirit of God? Am I walking powerfully in the Spirit of the Lord according to His Word? When people come and seek counsel from you, are you quick to give them the Word of God? I remember years ago we had a fellow come, sweet guy, loves the Lord, but he said, hey, I want to teach the men. I want to do a men's fellowship. And I'm like, well, what would you teach them? So, well, you know, I've had a lot of years in walking with the Lord. I'd share with them about my walk, and I'd share with them about my marriage and about these different things, the wisdom I've gleaned over the years. And I told the fellow, thank you, but no thanks. You know why? Because what I wanted him to give the men is the Word of God. I want the men in this fellowship to be men of the Word of God. I want the women in this fellowship to be women of the Word of God, learning the wisdom from God. And again, now we can all have wisdom that we glean from, you know, more mature people in the faith, and that's kind of what I'm saying here, that all of a sudden, here's Samuel, dude, what's going on? And Eli explained, hey, look, you know, look what he goes on to say in verse 9. He says, now go lie down. And if he calls you, you shall say, speak, Lord, for your servant listeneth. So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Verse 10, and the Lord came and stood calling as at other times, Samuel, Samuel. And Samuel said, speak, for your servant hears. Now notice he didn't say, speak, Lord. I don't think it was out of disrespect. I think, I don't know about you, but I would have been a little nervous. Now, we can't assume that, but I think we can kind of like, hey, I don't know about him. Samuel might have had the peace of the Lord on him. I don't know, but it's interesting. The Lord calls him, but he just says, speak, for your servant hears. You know, what a great application for us as Christians this evening. As I was thinking, it's just like, hey, when we open up our Bible to read, when we come to a Bible study such as tonight or on Sunday mornings or Wednesday or Thursday nights or other times, when we listen to a sermon on the radio or on our iPhones or on our, you know, other devices, when we read a Christian book, when we take time before the Lord, you know, when we and do these things as we're coming to a study, as we open our Bible, do we open up and just say, speak, Lord, your servant listeneth. Here I am, Lord, just tell me. Tell me about yourself. Tell me what you desire of me today. Tell me how to live my life. Tell me what not to do. Tell me what to do, Lord. Because I'm your servant. Speak, man. I just want to hear from you. And I love that heart, preparing our hearts. You know, what a great example for us to prepare our hearts to listen to what the Lord our God would speak to us today. Can I have an amen? Because God is still alive. Can I have an amen to that? He hasn't retired. He hasn't, you know, gone off and, hey, you know, he is still active. He is still alive. And he still wants to speak to us even today and to be used for his glory to a lost and fallen world. Now look at verse 11. Then the Lord said to Samuel, behold, I am about to do a thing in Israel, at which the two ears of everyone who hears it will tingle. On that day I will fulfill against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house from beginning to end. And I declare to him that I am about to punish his house forever for the iniquity that he knew. Notice, it was for the iniquity that he knew, because his sons were blaspheming God and he did not restrain them. Therefore, I swear to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be atoned for by sacrifice or offering forever. Eli's greatest sin was nepotism. Jeff came up to me at the end of the last study. He's like, hey, isn't that called nepotism when we're talking about Eli and his sons? That's exactly what it's called. So basically, he'd been practicing nepotism, placing his kids in the ministry, and they were using the ministry for their own gain and sinfulness, which actually brought them to a place where they were blaspheming against the Lord, man. I mean, think about it. All the offerings, they were taking the best of the offerings, the women that would come to serve the Lord. They're fornicating with them. And Eli, I mean, this is what freaks me out, dude. Eli was warned by a man of God, comes to him and said, dude, Eli, this is what's going to happen. And it's just crazy. And again, because here in verse 13, we read that he did not restrain them even as they were blaspheming God. You know, it's interesting, being in the ministry and being a Christian for many years now, I've seen this happen over and over again to many men I've respected even and loved, and they've fallen into this whole thing of nepotism, raising up people within their families, and they go in and they start to do these things that are ungodly, unholy, and yet the parents just seem to kind of wink their eyes. It's a sad thing. And we have to be careful of that. And I tell you what, man, I pray that I have a heart that's open to heeding the rebukes of the Lord if I ever fall into this someday. Yet the Lord is telling Samuel that it is time for him to judge the house of Eli and fulfill his promises through the man of God who came to Eli. You know, just a quick thing on judgment. You know, there's some people out there today who teach that the Old Testament, we've talked about this before, is wooden. Basically, I've been told that the writers of the Old Testament didn't understand the love of God, so a lot of what they wrote didn't reflect accurately, you know, the Lord. Hey, turn with me to Colossians chapter 3, if you would. Colossians chapter 3. We'll start in verse 5. Colossians 3, verse 5, it says, therefore put to death your members which are on the earth, fornication, uncleanness, passion, evil desire, and covetousness, which is idolatry. Now check out verse 6. Because of these things, the wrath of God is coming upon the sons of disobedience. You see, beloved in Christ, there is coming a time, it's called the tribulation and great tribulation, where the wrath of God will be poured out upon this whole world. After we have been taken up, or what we call the rapture of the church, during that time there will come the tribulation, and it'll be a 7-year period of God pouring out his judgment upon the earth. And the last 3.5 years is actually called the Great Tribulation, where God is pouring out his wrath upon a Christ-rejecting world. Now, the cool part is, we're going to see, and we're going to talk about this in a little while too, but the neat part is, even in the midst of that, God is still looking for people to repent. Now, check it out. Look at verse 15. Samuel lay until the morning. Then he opened the doors of the house of the Lord. And Samuel was afraid to tell the vision to Eli. I would have been afraid too, dude. It's like, whoa. You know, it can be a very fearful thing to biblically approach people that we need to do, especially people we love and respect if they're in sin. They've fallen into sin. But in Galatians chapter 6, verses 1 through 4, we read this. Brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks he is something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. You see, Samuel had some bad news to share with Eli. He was afraid. And sometimes we can be afraid to approach people. Jesus said, if someone sins against you, we need to go to that person. He also said, look, if you've sinned against someone else and you remember, even if you're at the altar, leave your gift, go to that person and be reconciled. So many of us, well, I'm just going to leave the church and go to another church. I'm not going to approach that person. I'm just going to pray for them. You know what's funny? We're doing what's right in our own eyes and not what the Lord has called us to do. You see, the greatest love is to go to that person as we're shown biblically with the spirit of meekness and humility, but to restore them. To find restoration, not just with one another, but with the Lord. Now look at verse 16 back in our text. But Eli called Samuel and said, Samuel, my son. And he said, here I am. And Eli said, "What was it that he told you? Do not hide it from me. May God do so to you and more also if you hide anything from me of all that he told you." So Samuel told him everything and hid nothing from him. And he said, Eli said, "It is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him." You know, the strange thing that when we see this, here's Eli the priest, and we're going to find out later that he was actually a judge too in the nation of Israel. He judged for, I think it was 40 years. And here he is, and yet he's not a man of the word of God either. The saddest thing to me is we're reading through this, why didn't Eli repent? And he knew that it was still going to happen. There'd still be consequences. But why not come before the Lord and say, "Lord, man, I have blown it. I am so sorry. Please forgive me. And I've done all the..." But he wouldn't do it. Oh, notice what he says there in verse 18. It is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him. It's crazy. You see, in 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 10, it says, "Godly grief produces a repentance that leads to salvation without regret, whereas worldly grief produces death." We don't even read that he was sorry. You know, it's a tragic thing when I meet Christians or professing Christians, because I don't know if they've ever really repented of their sin, but they don't care about sin. They don't care about sin even in their own lives or the lives of others. They don't care that sin leads us to hell, that if we practice these things, we're told over and over in the Bible that we will not inherit the kingdom of God. We need to have a godly sorrow over our sin. And notice, a godly grief that produces a repentance that leads to salvation. You know, it's interesting, as I mentioned a moment ago in the book of Revelation, dude, in the midst of the great tribulation, you know, all this stuff going on, we read in Revelation chapter 9. Let's just go ahead and turn there real quick. Revelation chapter 9, starting in verse 20. Revelation chapter 9, starting in verse 20. Revelation 9, 20 and 21. It says, "But the rest of mankind who were not killed by these plagues," notice, "did not repent of the works of their hands." Now again, this shows us that the Lord was looking for them to repent. It goes on though, look at, "that they should not worship demons, idols of gold and silver," or silver, brass, stone, and wood, "which can neither see nor hear nor walk." Verse 21, "and they did not repent of their murders or sorceries or of their sexual immorality or thefts." Dude, it sounds a lot like today, doesn't it? Flip over to chapter 16. We're going to see the Lord's heart again. So again, the Lord was looking for people to repent. Chapter 16, starting in verse 8. Chapter 16, verses 8 through 11. "Then the fourth angel poured out his bowl on the sun, and power was given to him to scorch men with fire. And men were scorched with great heat, and they blasphemed the name of God who has power over these plagues, and they did not repent and give him glory." There it is again. The Lord, in the midst of all this, looking for people to repent. Look at verse 10. "Then the fifth angel poured out his bowl on the throne of the beast, and his kingdom became full of darkness, and they gnawed their tongues because of the pain. They blasphemed the God of heaven because of their pains and their sores, and did not repent of their deeds." Dude, even in the midst of God pouring out his wrath, he was looking for repentance. Man, again, here's Eli back in our text, verse 18. Let's let the Lord do what seems good. He would not repent. Now look at verse 19. "And Samuel grew, and the Lord was with him, and let none of his words fall to the ground. And all of Israel, from Dan to Beersheba, knew that Samuel was established as a prophet of the Lord." Hey, you might want to underline that, highlight that in your Bibles, because we're going to come up to see that even though they knew that he was a prophet of the Lord, they didn't come to him. Look at verse 21. "And the Lord appeared again at Shiloh, For the Lord revealed himself to Samuel at Shiloh by the word of the Lord. You know, again, here's an exciting and glorious thing happening in Israel. They hadn't had a prophet who was speaking the word of God. Notice it said, for the Lord revealed himself to Samuel at Shiloh by the word of the Lord. And the Lord appeared there again at Shiloh. This is a glorious thing. Samuel is speaking for the Lord. And notice we're told that none of his words were falling to the ground. In other words, everything that Samuel was saying would come to pass. Guess what? They were coming to pass. His prophecies were coming true. Everything that he was saying. And notice in verse 20, it says, because of all this, because that Samuel, all the words were established, Israel knew that Samuel was established as a prophet of the Lord. You know what's interesting? There is a gift of prophecy for today. Can I have an amen? The Bible teaches us very clearly in the New Testament. There's also a gift of prophets for today. Did we know that too? Just as there's pastor, teacher, there are prophets for the building up, for the edification of the church, to equip the saints for the work of the ministry. But you know what's sad is these two offices, or one office and gift, have been so abused. I can't tell you how many people have come up to me personally and told me prophecies ever since I was the age 19 and came to Christ. There was prophecies given all throughout my life that were false. One after another, after another, after another. We had one lady come up to us many years ago. We'd been at church for just a couple years, and this lady came up and, there's the spirit of Cain here at the church, and you know, this church is going to be to the ground. Thus saith the Lord. Literally, she says, thus saith the Lord, this church will be to the ground by this time next year. Not one person will be attending. I still wait for her to come today. Would love to see her again. Because I even told her, I said, well, you know, that the Bible says that, you know, you would take a false prophet and you'd stone them if they were wrong at all. I said, so if you're wrong, can we take you all back and stone you? And I was joking, but I was bringing home a point that people, so many today, there's a whole movement called the Kansas City Prophets. There's a whole other apostolic prophet movement going on. Bill Johnson there in Reading and others. Carrie Jobe, maybe a lot of Carrie Jobe or whatever, a lot of her, you don't know, but she's kind of into this whole wacky apostolic, wacky doctrine stuff. Her dad is one of the prophets of old or whatever, apostles. And so, I mean, it's pervasive throughout the church, and it's growing, by the way. And so how do we know? How do we know if someone says they're a prophet, or, you know, if they have a prophecy? Well, number one, we know by, does it align with the word of God? Can I have an amen? Does it line up with the word of God? 1 Corinthians 14:29. Let two or three prophets speak and let the others judge. You see, when someone gives a prophecy, we're to take it and to judge it according to the word of God. Galatians chapter 1, verses 8 and 9. But even if we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel to you than what we have preached to you, let him be accursed. As we said before, so now I say again, if anyone preaches another gospel to you than what you have received, let him be accursed. So if someone comes and they're trying to preach in the name of God, and they're telling, well, thus saith the Lord, and there are many who say that today. I'm a prophet. I had some fellow was calling a gal I knew in England. Oh, she's the prophetess of England. I'm like, hey, bro, you need to dial back on the rhetoric there. That's not biblical. And that's not Calvary Chapel, because this gal is even part of Calvary Chapel. And all the guy unfriended me, was all upset with me. So be it. I don't care. So first of all, we can tell a prophecy or a prophet, is what they're saying, does it align up with the word of God? And secondly, does the prophecy come true? Does it happen? So first and foremost, does it align with the word of God? And secondly, does it come true? And again, we see here within our text this evening, if it does, we can see that it is a true word from God. Now look at verse 21. Because again, they knew that it was the Lord. And the Lord appeared again at Shiloh, for the Lord revealed himself to Samuel at Shiloh by the word of the Lord. And the word of Samuel came to all Israel. Now Israel went out to battle against the Philistines. And they encamped at Ebenezer, and the Philistines encamped at Aphek. The Philistines drew up in line against Israel, and when the battle spread, Israel was defeated by the Philistines, who killed about 4,000 men on the field of battle. And when the troops came to the camp, the elders of Israel said, "Why has the Lord defeated us today before the Philistines? Let us bring the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord here from Shiloh, that it may come among us and save us from the power of our enemies." Wow. You know, here we have a perfect example of the last sentence of the book of Judges. Let me just read it to you from Judges 21, verse 25. "In those days there was no king in Israel, and everyone did what was right in his own eyes." So here they are. Even now, as we read this, at the end of chapter 3, all the people of Israel had heard about Samuel and that the Lord was speaking to Samuel. His word went through all the kingdom. And yet they go out, even though they knew the Lord was speaking through Samuel. Notice they didn't come to seek the Lord. "Hey, Lord, what do you say about this battle? Should we go out against the Philistines? What should we do?" So, again, why didn't they come to the Lord by Samuel and ask him what they should do? Even after they were defeated and they lost some 4,000 men, they blamed God. Why did God defeat us? Hey, let's go back and get the Ark of God, the Ark of the Lord. Let's bring that, then we'll be fine. Let's go get our lucky rabbit's foot. You see, why didn't they come and inquire of the Lord? Was it pride? Was it ignorance? Perhaps it was both. Yet what's interesting, the end result is they did what was right in their own eyes. And remember, not just in their own world, like, well, should we buy this house or this car or this job? No, these are things of the spiritual realm. Should we go to battle? Should we do this? They did what they thought was right, and they paid dearly for it. You know, beloved in Christ, we're told that we have, part of the reason we have the Old Testament is for an example for us how to live today as Christians. So as we look at this example tonight, man, we need to be careful, beloved in Christ, since we do have the Word of God, the canon of Scripture here in these 66 books written by some 40 authors, we have it. We have the Word of God. And by the way, when we need the will of God, we need to come and seek it from the God of the Word, through His Word, by the Holy Spirit of God, not to be doing what seems right in our own eyes. You see, it can become easy for us as Christians to assume that simply because we've been born again of the Spirit of God and we have the Holy Spirit living within us, that everything we do, everything we say is fine with God. See, there's a lot of Christians, the Lord loves me, it's all under grace, I'm just gonna, you know, no big deal, it's all good with God. He doesn't care what I do or what I say because of God's grace. And we come to the same place that they are right now. You see, we must not claim ignorance. We must not be prideful. We must always come to the Lord and seek Him first and foremost in our lives, for His will in our lives. How do we do that? We first and foremost, again, come to the Word of God. We come to the Bible. I can't tell you how many times, even this morning as I was reading, spending my time, and then finishing up the study this afternoon, how many things I just read this morning are applied in the Scripture today. Or as I read things, Lord, I'm praying about this in my life, and the Lord, all of a sudden I'm reading through the Word, and whoa, dude, boom. Right there, the Lord answers that question time and time again. But seeking first and foremost, hey, Lord, what would you have me to do? To learn also, by the way, to learn what not to do, to learn how not to live, to learn how to live in the positive commandments of the Word of God. To come to the Word and say, hey, speak, Lord, your servant listeneth. I'm not just going to hear what you say, Lord Jesus. I'm going to do what you say. So as we come to him first and foremost through his word, secondly, we come to him humbly by prayer. We seek the Lord. We, you know, by the power of his spirit, we come and we submit ourselves to the Lord under his word, and we seek his will through prayer, through fasting, through hearing, through his word in our lives. To be men and women who have a prayer closet, a space at home where we go and we can just be alone with the Lord, just to hear from him, to pray over the scriptures that we're reading for that day, to meditate upon them, to talk to our Lord, to hear from our Lord. You know, we just have to be careful, especially again in the days that we're living in, not to do what is right in our eyes, but what's right in his eyes. You know, and one last thing. Perhaps we've been, you know, living for a long time as Christians, and yet we've been living in disobedience to the Lord and his word. You know what? If we're still breathing, we can repent. Can I have an amen? Amen. Dude, if we're still breathing, if you're here tonight, if you're watching online, guess what? You can still change by the power of God. Don't come out of this study tonight without being changed by God's word, without being empowered by his Holy Spirit to be changed. Lord, how would you have me to be changed in this? Lord, I want to repent of this thought or of this way of life or, you know, whatever. And that's where we find the true grace of God. Amen? True forgiveness at the cross, man. Hey, he's ready. He's willing to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Yet check it out here in our text. This is not what the people did. Notice in verse 3, coming into verse 4, they continued in their own spiritual things that they thought would help, without going to the Lord first and foremost. Look at verse 4. So the people sent to Shiloh and brought from there the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord of Hosts, who is enthroned on the cherubim. And the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, were there with the Ark of the Covenant of God. And as soon as the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord came into camp, all Israel gave a mighty shout so that the earth resounded. Dude, they were excited. They were stoked. So basically, not to go too far away from the text or, you know, to go too far astray, but do you notice how they had worked themselves up into a sort of spiritual frenzy here? They were doing what they thought was spiritual. Let's go and let's get the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord of Hosts. You know, and notice the two priests come, man. Oh, you know, the two sons of Eli are here too, Hophni and Phinehas. To be honest, that should have been warning right there. They all surely knew about these guys, how wicked they were. But what did they do? Look at verse 5. Man, as soon as the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord came into camp, all of Israel gave a mighty shout so that the earth resounded. You know, again, they were doing what they thought was spiritual, what they thought were right, and they got so excited where they're shouting and just excited. But you know what? As I read this, I'm not sorry, but I couldn't help think of so many worship services that we see today. It's all about doing what is right and holy and religious in their eyes, not in the eyes of the Lord. It's all about hyping everybody up, getting them excited, just like the Israelites were so excited. Let's play loud music. Let's have killer lights. Let's, you know, have, you know, smoke coming down off the stage. Let's get everybody hyped up. It's crazy, and it reminds me of this scene here. They're hooting and hollering, you know, during all this quote-unquote worship going on, giving a mighty shout in some of these churches so that the earth resounds, and yet they too shall fall when the battle comes, as we're going to see here in our text in just a moment, because they will find that the house they have been building upon is the house of sand, because it's not in obedience to the word of God. Even in their worship, it's not okay to worship the Lord. It's not okay to do spiritual things unless it's in accordance to the word of God. Now look at verse 6. And when the Philistines heard the noise of the shouting, they said, "What does this great shouting in the camp of the Hebrews mean?" And when they learned that the ark of the Lord had come to the camp, the Philistines were afraid. For they said, "A God has come into the camp." And they said, "Woe to us, for nothing like this has happened before. Woe to us, who can deliver us from the power of these mighty gods? These are the gods who struck the Egyptians with every sort of plague in the wilderness. Take courage and be men, O Philistines, lest you become slaves to the Hebrews as they have been to you. Be men and fight." Dude, look at the enemy. The Israelites are getting all worked up. It's like almost like, you know, going to a big feast of a meal and it turns out just to be cotton candy. They're getting all worked up, and even the Philistines, they're afraid. Dude, woe to us, verse 8. Who can deliver us? Oh, and they even remember back to the Egyptians. All the peoples of the world knew about the Egyptians and what the Hebrew God had done. Seems like the only people who forgot were the Israelites. Can't that be the same in our lives sometimes, though? Forgetting the power of God, forgetting the power of His Word, forgetting the incredible things that we can do as Christians for the Lord to bring Him glory. Notice, the enemies of the Israelites were intimidated by their false spirituality. Interesting. Well, let's see how it pans out. Look at verse 10. So the Philistines fought, and Israel was defeated, and they fled, every man to his home. And there was a great slaughter, for there fell of Israel 30,000 foot soldiers, and the ark of God was captured, and the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, died. Now think about this. 30,000 foot soldiers dead. Two priests, Hophni and Phinehas, the sons of Eli, dead. The Ark of God captured. But it all sounded great. It all sounded so spiritual. It all sounded so exciting. You know, I've been around Christianity long enough to where I've seen all these false doctrines and all the wounded and the dead, basically, spiritually, that have been left in the wake. You know, of the positive confession movement, the health and wealth gospel, all the different things, and even today, this weird kind of hybrid that's kind of everything all thrown in together, the Reformed hyper-Calvinism thrown in with the word faith stuff and all this just disgusting stuff. You know, it's interesting, and notice, again, to me, it parallels a lot of what our worship can be today. Just fake. Just hype. Just cotton candy. You know, I heard read the story of, you know, a guy who asked another guy after church, "Hey, how was the worship?" And the guy replied, "I don't know, you'll have to ask God, because it wasn't about me, it was about Him." Do we hear that? Whether it's us up here, there's a worship band, one guy, one gal, whatever it is, it's not about how we feel after the word. It's how, Lord, how is it for you? It's all about you. It's about bringing you glory and honor and praise to your name. And we need to be careful. And I'm going to say this especially to the youngers out here today. Because they want to get you caught up. Oh, we got this radio artist there. We got this great Christian artist there. We got this. Hey, I'm not saying we can never go to Christian concerts. I'm not saying that. But be careful. I remember back in the 70s, there was a guy named Keith Green, wonderful man of the Lord. He wrote a great book called No Compromise. And in that, he talked about how he pushed hard back against the Christian music industry because he saw a lot of people being idolized, even back then. And to be honest, I think it's even more manifold today. We need to be careful because it's not about how, when I go and I sing, you know, this guy's songs or this gal's, I just feel great. It's not about us. We're misunderstanding what worship is. And guess what? When the storms come, when the things come, guess what? Just as Jesus said, great is the fall of that house whose house is built on the sand, and the storms come and the wind blows, great is the fall of that house. And the Bible said, Jesus said, this is the one who hears my words and does not heed them, does not obey them. Now Israel, man, they forgot. Notice they said, hey, let's bring the ark with them. Let's be religious. Oh, maybe I'll bring my Bible with me to this place and God will just do neat things, or I'll make sure I have my cross on my neck, or, you know, this special thing. It's not about that. It is about the Lord God himself. Just because Israel forgot this, it's so important. Just because they brought the ark with them, or just because now we're going to see, you know, that they get really bummed because the ark has been captured. God isn't captured. Can I have an amen? God isn't in that box. But Israel forgot that. They were so spiritually worked up because of what they thought was spiritual, and yet it brought defeat. And we need to be careful, beloved, in Christ. Look at verse 12. A man of Benjamin ran from the battle line and came to Shiloh the same day with his clothes torn and with dirt on his head. And when he arrived, Eli was sitting on his seat by the road watching, for his heart trembled for the ark of God. And when the man came into the city, he told the news, and all the city cried out. See, their hope was in the ark, not in the God of the ark. Interesting, isn't it? When Eli heard the sound of the outcry, he said, "What is this uproar?" Then the man hurried and came to him and told Eli. Now Eli was 98 years old, and his eyes were set so that he could not see. And the man said to Eli, "I am he who has come from the battle. I fled from the battle today." Now, we're not going to go into this, but if you want to go back and read over this chapter later, note how many times "fled from battle" comes up from the Israelites. You know, when we read in Ephesians chapter 6, the spiritual armor that we have, guess what? It's always for moving forward. There's nothing protecting our backs. We're not to flee from battle. We're to stand up against the wiles of the devil. Okay, we flee from sexual temptation, amen? That's when we turn and run. But it's just interesting. You read that over and over. "I fled from the battle today." And he said, "How did it go, my son?" Verse 17. "He who brought the news answered and said, 'Israel has fled.'" There it is again. "Before the Philistines. And there has also been a great defeat among the people. Your two sons also, Hophni and Phinehas, are dead. And the ark of God has been captured." As soon as he mentioned the ark of God, Eli fell over backward from his seat by the side of the gate, and his neck was broken, and he died. For the man was old and heavy. He had judged Israel 40 years. Check it out. There you go, verse 18. He was a judge of Israel. First time it's mentioned. Pretty sad, isn't it? Here we learn just a few things. First of all, that Eli was, again, not only the high priest over the temple of the Lord, but he was also a judge. He had judged Israel for 40 years, and yet had not been a very godly judge, again, especially in the area of his family. Secondly, we see that the prophecy of the Lord, remember, has now come true, that his two sons, Hophni and Phinehas, died on the same day. And lastly, we know, check it out, that when Eli heard of his sons, he didn't fall over backwards. It wasn't when he heard about the ark. When he heard about the ark of God being captured, he fell backward, he breaks his neck and dies. He was 98 years old. We read that he was a heavy man, and now the Lord has judged the house of Eli. In my notes, I wrote, sigh. How sad. Sigh. And on top of this, think about it, the ark of the Lord, the ark of God, has for the first time ever now falls into the hands of the enemy. Look at verse 19. And his daughter-in-law, the wife of Phinehas, was pregnant, about to give birth. And when she heard the news that the ark of God was captured and that her father-in-law and her husband were dead, she bowed and gave birth, for her pains came upon her. And about the time of her death, notice she's going to die now after she gives birth, the woman attending her said to her, "Do not be afraid, for you have borne a son." But she did not answer or pay attention, and she named the child Ichabod. saying, "The glory has departed from Israel because the ark of God had been captured and because of her father-in-law and her husband." And she said, "The glory has departed from Israel, for the ark of God has been captured." So sad, where even the priest, where the daughter-in-law of the priest had it all mixed up. They're saying, "Oh, we don't have the ark anymore, so the glory of the Lord has departed." Had the glory of the Lord departed? No. He was still speaking afresh through Samuel. He was still there. God is omnipresent. That means he is everywhere at one time. It's an impossibility, by the way, this house is haunted. Don't go there because it's haunted. First of all, there's no such thing as ghosts. There are such things as demons. But guess who's, in the haunted house? God. He is everywhere, all the time. So again, their theology was messed up, so it led two people to death because they had bad theology. They were hoping in an ark. Actually, it led to 30,000 deaths on top of that. But their bad theology led them to dying. And what's so sad here is, notice the wife of Phinehas dies, she gives birth to a son, and as she's dying, "I'm going to name my son Ichabod." Dude, the name Ichabod literally means there is no glory. The glory is gone, it is departed. Imagine having that name for the rest of your life. "Son, we named you Ichabod." Or maybe, "I'm going to rename you Ichabod." I don't know. But she names, basically again, Ichabod, and all this because, as we come down, her husband died, the father of this newborn son died because of nepotism, and the sins of their father too, by the way. But again, because grandpa wouldn't, correct his sons, now the grandson is left fatherless and motherless. Now, even today, when someone says Ichabod within the church, they're referring to this, that the glory of the Lord has gone away from that church or from this man of the Lord. It's an Ichabod, or has departed from that ministry, or different things. And again, sadly, here's Israel. They've fallen into this sin of believing that the Lord had departed. Perhaps as we're closing, I think sometimes we can feel that way too. That the Lord has departed. Where is God in all of this? Where is the Lord in my suffering or this thing that just happened? Or man, we look around the world and it's so crazy. We need to understand that if we look around the world, guess who is at work in the world? The Lord. Guess who's still at work in our lives in the midst of the pain, in the midst of the suffering? The Lord. Hey, don't cry Ichabod, because that's a lie of the enemy. But so many, even within Christianity, believe it. The Lord can't use me anymore because of this. The Lord doesn't love me because this thing happened to me. You know where we look to find the love of Christ? It's never in our circumstances, beloved. It's always to the cross of Jesus Christ, period. That's where we point. You don't go, Jesus loves you so much, da, da, da. No, Jesus loves you so he died for us. We want to know how much God loves us? Because he died for us, not because our life is going to be without trials. Matter of fact, Jesus promised us that we would have even more trials by being his followers. Beloved, just remember, maybe there is some sin in your life that you've never repented of. Remember, we can come to the cross. There's a thing where, there's condemnation and there's conviction. Condemnation keeps us away from the cross. I feel so condemned over this sin I did. I feel so condemned over that. But the conviction of the Holy Spirit leads us straight to the cross of Christ and to our knees before the Lord in holy repentance. So, man, again, remember, come to the Lord. Believe his forgiveness if you need to. If things have happened or, will happen in our lives, remember the cross and the great love of God for us. Don't let bad theology ruin your life. That's why, again, be a man, be a woman of the Word of God, and remember, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet in all these things we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. Amen? For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, neither height nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Can I have an amen? Amen. Let's pray. Father, as we read of Israel, may we see ourselves there, Lord. Our own shortcomings, Lord, our own doubts, Lord. But may we also see Jesus, Lord. We also see you and your mighty hand at work, Lord. May we stand upon your word. May we be men and women of good, sound theology, Lord, as we read your word. Father, we lift up our brothers and sisters around the world, Lord, who are being persecuted even now. Those in Egypt that we were praying for earlier, their families, Lord, of those killed as they came together to celebrate you. Lord, we lift up those all around the world who are being persecuted for their faith, Lord. Lord, we lift up their persecutors, Lord. May they repent and know you truly as Lord and Savior. We lift up our country in this time of turmoil, Lord. We pray for mercy. Lord, we lift up the church to you, Lord. Strengthen us. Empower us, Lord, by your Spirit through your word. In Jesus' wondrous name we pray. Amen. Let's stand together.